بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله، نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه، ونعوذ بالله تعالى من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن سيدنا وحبيبنا وأسوتنا وقائدنا محمدًا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين وأصحابه أجمعين، وعلى كل من تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا، وانفعنا بما علمتنا، وزدنا علما وعملا يا رب العالمين. اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه، وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه. وبعد، respected علماء، friends, brothers, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuh. If I could ask just some of the brothers who are scattered at the back to slightly move a few inches forward, inshallah. A gathering which is united and sat together. We are already disunited. We don't want to be disunited here. There's a lot of space in the middle. Maybe we've kept them for the jinns, I think. You know, they say that some places, in some of the madaris, in Darul Uloom Deoband, I heard this from my father who used to study there many, many years ago, that they, in the Dawra Hadith, they keep the front areas, spaces free for the jinn students who are studying Sahih al-Bukhari. And it's true. They would keep that the students sit from the back and there's a space in the front, and that's where all the jinn students, you have jinn muhaddithun, jinn fuqaha, ulama, mufti, mashayikh, just like human beings. وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. Allah has created both ins and jinn, human and jinn kind, for His worship. Anyway, that's not my topic. Alhamdulillah, it's an honor, it's a privilege to be invited today by Abu Bakr Trust, Jami' Abu Bakr, to this auspicious gathering today, the Khatam of Sahih al-Bukhari, and a very important event. Many mashayikh and ulama will be addressing today's program. I would like to thank Mawlana Luqman, his brother Mawlana Ramadan, who's actually my class fellow and an old friend, and the whole team. May Allah reward them, reward their efforts. May Allah reward all of you for coming today and spending your time, inshallah, on a, is it Sunday today, right? Sunday, at this very important gathering. I don't want to take too much time, just briefly. I want to touch upon a particular aspect which I will require you to sort of pay attention to, inshallah ta'ala. This deen that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed us with, this deen that Allah has given us, Islam, we should be thankful, we should be grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He gave us this deen. He created us in the ummah of our Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Regarding this deen, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Quran, regarding the teachings of this deen, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, إِنَّا نَحْنُ نَزَّلْنَا الذِّكْرَ وَإِنَّا لَهُ لَحَافِظُونَ. إِنَّا نَحْنُ نَزَّلْنَا الذِّكْرَ وَإِنَّا لَهُ لَحَافِظُونَ. That indeed we have revealed the dhikr to you, O Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Indeed, we have revealed the dhikr. What is the dhikr? Dhikr refers to the Quran. Indeed, we have revealed the Quran to you. Wa inna lahu lahafidhun. And surely it will be us who will preserve, who will protect, who will safeguard this Quran. What does this verse tell us? In this verse, our Lord and our Creator, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is informing us that it is my duty, it is my responsibility. Allah has taken it upon Himself. Allah is promising us that this Quran, this dhikr, will be preserved, protected, safeguarded. Indeed, we have revealed the dhikr. In another verse, Allah says, وَأَنزَلْنَا إِلَيْكَ الذِّكْرَ لِتُبَيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ مَا نُزِّلَ إِلَيْهِمْ. O Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, O Messenger, we have revealed the dhikr, again, the Quran, to you so that you explain to the people that which has been revealed to them. Allah has taken the responsibility upon Himself to preserve, to guard this Quran, this text. Now this verse actually doesn't mean that only Allah has taken the responsibility of preserving the Quran. Actually, this can be understood in three parts. The promise, the wa'd, the promise of preservation, of guarding, is of three aspects of deen. Not just one aspect. How many aspects? Three. Number one is this Quran. Allah says, we have revealed the Quran to you. We shall surely preserve it. Alhamdulillah. We praise Allah. Until Yawmul Qiyamah, until today and Yawmul Qiyamah, we know for a fact, and not just us, it's not just we are claiming, it's not only Muslims are boasting. Historians, many Orientalists, non-Muslim historians, they have all written, they have all attested to the fact that the Muslims have a book. They have the Holy Scripture. Their Quran is such that no word, no letter has been changed or altered or moved from its place. Yes, there's those seven variations we read. We heard Sheikh Sa'id Inayatullah's son reciting, you know, Qira' al-Hafs from Asim and Warsh and Qalun, and we have all of these. These are all parts of the same. These are variations, part of the same text of the Quran. Allah has taken upon Him the responsibility of preserving the text, the nas, the words, the language of the Quran. No letter, no word has been changed or moved or altered since the time of Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when the Quran was revealed. Throughout how many? 200 years, 300 years, 400 years, 500 years, over 1400 years, nearly 1500 years, until Yawmul Qiyamah. How do we know that? What's the proof? Someone asks you, brother. Let's, oh Muslim, come here. Yo, come here. You go in Walsall or Birmingham. You say your Quran is, you know, not tampered with. What's your proof? Yeah, people ask for proof, Dalil. What's your proof? Oh, I think I heard, yeah. Because what's the proof? We should know. I mean, how do you know that the Quran, this Quran that we have in the masjids everywhere, it's preserved? Someone told you, your father told you, your mother told you. Of course, we listen to them, we accept them, but we should know for ourselves. How do we know this Quran has not been tampered or changed with? What's the proof? This Quran is known as mutawatir. Mutawatir, do you know what mutawatir means? This is the strongest way, the strongest proof ever. The strongest proof of establishing a fact ever is when something is related to us through multiple chains. Like for example, look, I'll ask you a question. Can somebody put their hands up who has never been for Umrah or Hajj? No, have you never seen Kaaba? There's a brother here, there's a brother there, there's a brother there. Brother there, you've never seen Kaaba, yes? Never seen Kaaba? Never. How do you know that there's a place called Makkah and Kaaba exists? How do you know? There could be an international conspiracy from family members, relatives, friends. Every time you meet him, tell him, Makkah, hey, Kaaba, everyone's... How do you know? The whole world could be making it up. You've never seen the Kaaba. Everyone, they just made a conspiracy. Is it possible? No. Because you hear from me, Kaaba, and you hear from him. I've never met him. Me and him, we've never spoken. So how can we conspire and make this, unless there's an agenda, but there's people who are telling you who have never met one another. This is what you call mutawatir. The Quran has been transmitted when Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when the verses were revealed to him, he spoke the verses, he uttered the verses. The Sahaba heard from the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, groups of people relating from groups, generation after generation, from the generation after generation, from him till today, multiple different people from different planets, from different languages, from different backgrounds, from different ethnicities have been transmitting the Quran, that it's impossible for you to come to a conclusion, for us to come to a conclusion, that this is a fabrication or a lie or somebody made this up. It's just not possible. This is why, just like we don't doubt that there's a place called Kaaba in Mecca, even though we have not seen it with our eyes, but it's what we call qat'i, it's absolute, it's the absolute truth. Likewise, this Quran, the words of the Quran, is exactly the same words that Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam uttered and spoke about and related to the Sahaba, from him generation. So Allah has taken responsibility that he is preserving the Quran. That's part one. And Allah uses, how is it preserved? It's preserved by me and you, by human beings, by look, just right now we heard so many small children who've memorized the Quran. So many children are memorizing the Quran. Allah uses individuals who memorize. The Quran can be burnt. In our history, Quran copies have been burnt, have been thrown into the water in Dajla in Iraq, where the ink became black. Quranic, you know, people have, the Quran has been destroyed. Yet it was not possible to extinguish or remove the Quran from this world, because people have it in their hearts. And actually, the preservation through heart and mind is actually more powerful. Do you know that in the earlier times, nowadays it's sad, everything we write, we don't use our memory. In the early times, people used to use their memory more than they used to write. I have to have notes, people, because we don't use our memory anymore. In the earlier times, people used to rely on their memory. This was more reliable than a piece of paper. I'm sure some people, there's one thing, you know your bank card? What's your passcode? The four numbers. Don't write it anywhere. That's something people, some people still write it, but some people, there's one brother said to me, that's the only passcode, the four-digit number. When I put my debit card or bank card into the ATM, that number, I don't even tell my wife. He was saying, nobody, not even my wife, nobody. That's the only thing in my head. So, Quran is protected and preserved. You know, if you look at the earlier generations, if you look at other faiths, and this is not to sort of discriminate against any faith or, you know, put anyone down, this is recorded in history. Even non-Muslim historians have written this in books, that in Islam, I will come to part two, Quran is the first part that Allah has preserved. But if you look at the Christianity and Judaism, they themselves, objective orientalists and historians themselves, have written that there is no guarantee that the Torah and the Injil is the actual version that was revealed unto Musa alayhi salatu wasalam and Isa, peace be upon him. Both, if you look at Musa alayhi salam, there's a gap, there's a generation of about 1,500. They have an isnad, what we call a chain. They have a chain, not multiple, but they have a chain. In ours, the Quran is like groups of people narrating, groups till today. They do have a chain, but that chain ends somewhere 1,500 years after Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. They say there's somebody who was cleaning Baytul Maqdis who actually claimed that, you know what, I am cleaning and I'm cleaning something, and under the ground I found the real copy of the Torah. And then they said, okay, this is the correct version. The Bible, we have four versions of the Bible, four different, you know, the book of Matthew and the book of Luke and the other two. This Bible, again, they don't have a chain going all the way back to Isa alayhi salatu wasalam. There was a time many hundred years after Sayyiduna Isa, Jesus, peace be upon him, that many people were claiming that they have the real version of the Bible. Ikhtilaf. Alhamdulillah, at least we don't have that ikhtilaf. We have a lot of ikhtilaf, but at least, you know, not some mosque saying, we've got the 31 Juz Quran. No, we've got 41. Hamare paas 40 paare hain. No, alhamdulillah, everyone's got the 30 same ajza, parts of the Quran at least. There was a big, massive ikhtilaf, difference of opinion. Someone said, no, we've got the correct version of the Bible, because lost, nobody really knows. Because these Bibles were written by the people who saw Isa alayhi salam. You should read the history of what the Bible is. Actually, it was people who started writing the halat, the biography of Isa alayhi salam and his teachings, etc. Anyway, so there's an incident mentioned by a non-Muslim historian that many hundred years ago, there was a massive difference of opinion in the Christian world, that which is the correct version of the Bible. So all the great mashayikh, the great leaders of the Christian faith, the great scholars and the ulama, the pastors and the bishops and whatever, they all had an international conference that this is problem, what should we do? So they said, you know what, let's all get together. They all had a big massive event and gathering. They discussed, deliberated the issue that there's so many, there's about 15, 20 different versions. So one of them suggested that, look, you know what we do? Let's get all these versions of the Bible together and let's, inshallah, what we do? I don't know if they said inshallah, I just put that for myself. But they said, let's put all these versions of the Bible and in a sacred place, on a table, let's put them all on the table. And then all of us, what we do is at night, we all go away to our rooms, to our homes. And let's cry and make dua to Allah, beg to Allah. Oh Allah, oh God, you know, we don't really know which is the correct Bible. Oh God, we don't know which is the correct Bible. Please, when we come in the morning, just keep that Bible or those Bible versions which are correct on the table and let the false one, and let the batil and the false Bibles and the incorrect versions, let them all fall down from the table. Let them all fall. They said, yes, this is, let's ask Allah. They said, let's ask God himself. There's no other way. So they all agreed on this. They put all the 12, 15, 20 different, you know, versions of the Bible on top of the table. And they all went. In the morning, all of them, alhamdulillah, came back. When they came back, they saw four copies, versions of the Bible intact on the table. And the rest of them had fallen down. And they said, these are now the four correct versions, Book of Luke and Book of Matthew. These are the correct versions of the Bible. The historian non-Muslim, I'm not saying this, the historian non-Muslim who wrote this incident, they said, everyone agreed to this, but till today, nobody knows that who had the keys to that room for the night. And then they realized that the guy who suggested, let's do that, he had the keys in his pocket. At night. We're not going to have su'udan, but I don't know what happened. He had the keys. The one who said, let's keep all the Bible copies on the table, and in the morning, whichever's on the floor, they are the incorrect versions, and lock the door at night, and in the pocket, the keys. So this is with regards to the Bible, the Torah. Non-Muslims are saying this and writing this. With Islam, I said, Allah has taken upon himself to preserve إِنَّا نَحْنُ نَزَّلْنَا الذِّكْرَ وَإِنَّا لَهُ لَحَافِظُونَ. Not only the Quran, that's just part one. I just want to talk about part one, part two, part three. Part one is this, Quran has been preserved, the actual text of the Quran through generation after generation, through the Huffaz, through the Qurra, the Sahaba memorized the Quran, from them, you know, the Tabi'un memorized, and till today, young children, boys, girls, men, women have been memorizing. So there's absolute, you know, this confidence that we have that the Quran is the exact, the words of the Quran are the exact ones that were revealed unto the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Number two, this promise is not restricted to just to the Quran. It goes beyond that as well. When Allah said, we have revealed the dhikr to you, O Messenger, in another verse, we have revealed the dhikr to you, O Messenger, so that you explain to the people. So Allah's Messenger, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his explanation is also preserved. What's his explanation called? Anyone? What's the explanation called? Yes, brother? Hadith, sunnah. So part two is the promise to preserve is also for the sunnah. Even the hadith is preserved. We have revealed this dhikr to you so that you explain. Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his explanation, his interpretation, his explanation and interpretation of the Quran is what we call hadith, is what we call sunnah. This sunnah is also preserved. And for the preservation of this sunnah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this is why we have this something khususiyah. This is the speciality of our religion. Again, I will tell you this, non-Muslims have said this, Orientalists, that no faith has this speciality of isnad, chain of transmission. Every hadith Today we will have the khatam of Sahih al-Bukhari. And I just want to explain to you what does it mean. Some people come and they hear, they don't know what's going on. The student will read the, before he reads the text of the hadith, there will be a sanad, a chain. This chain is basically, I think I once heard on a recording that a student here, Abu Bakr Shas, I think it was his son, I think it was reciting from Mufti Taqi Usmani's sanad, that you have heard, recited Sahih al-Bukhari by your shaykh, who heard from his shaykh, from his shaykh, from his shaykh, from his teacher, his teacher, his teacher, all the way to who? Imam al-Bukhari. Now, look, what used to happen is that in the olden times, when books were not, there were no books, there was no Sahih al-Bukhari, Sahih Muslim, Sunan Tirmidhi, Sunan Ibn Majah, none of these books were written. People used to relate hadith just by words with their mouth, verbally. So every time you want to say a hadith to somebody, you want to give a bayan or a talk or a Jumu'ah khutbah, you can't just say, brothers, Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says in a hadith, such and such. You can't say that. People will say, sorry brother, give the chain. Without a chain, our ears are closed. Nobody would listen. Any statement, not just hadith, even if you want to make an explanation of the Quran or anything, even stories. That's why you'll find in books sometimes that there's like one word. Like in the Quran, Allah says, وَعْبُدْ رَبَّكَ حَتَّى يَأْتِيَكَ الْيَقِينَ. Worship your Lord until yaqeen comes to you. What does yaqeen mean? Al-yaqeen huwa al-maut. Yaqeen means death. Now you could just write that in one half a line. Yaqeen in the Quran means maut. But before that, in Tafsir ibn Kathir or wherever, the author will have to say, I heard from my sheikh, who heard from his sheikh, who heard from his sheikh, who heard from his sheikh, such and such, with the name. Three lines of names. That, for example, Abdullah ibn Abbas, the Sahabi, said, yaqeen here means maut. Every statement was backed up with a chain. So before these books came into existence, everyone would have to relate the hadith with a chain. That's why it would take a long time. Now do we do that? I just read a hadith in front of you. Or in a talk. Do we do that? We don't do that now. Why? We just say, it's in Sahih al-Bukhari, it's in Sahih Muslim. Because when the books were written, the author, like Imam al-Bukhari, when he wrote the hadith, he wrote it with a chain, then he wrote in the book, and then that book was published and printed into thousands of copies. Now those thousands of copies now have spread, now you don't need to have a chain. But we do have a chain from our teachers to Imam Bukhari, just as a means of blessings. As a means of blessings. That this is the shaykh who read Sahih al-Bukhari from his teacher, all the way to the author Imam al-Bukhari. And from him to Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the chain is before every hadith. So the second aspect of preservation of deen is hadith. And subhanallah, brothers, I'll tell you this. This is a unique aspect of this ummah. The way, you know, we just hear a hadith, it's so easy, pick up Sahih al-Bukhari or hear a hadith and people just study. The effort, the sacrifice, what people went through, starting from Sahaba radiallahu anhum. Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu was the first student Sahabi. He would lie on the floor, on the ground for days because of thirst and hunger, because he dedicated his life for studying the hadith of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The first madrasa in the masjid of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the Ashabu Sufa. And the Sahaba used to study by the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. From there, the hadiths were transmitted. Every hadith. Now, for ensuring that every hadith is absolutely authentic or not, because somebody could make something up. Imagine, we've lived nearly, you know, close to 1,500 years from Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Muslims everywhere in the world. Somebody could just give a khutbah, say, Assalamu alaikum. Nowadays, anyone could just give a khutbah or a bayan just to promote your own agenda. I heard the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam say, if you don't do this, then this will happen to you. You know, people make these hadiths up. Some people just see a dream and say, I made a hadith up. There have been people, there's one person who said that he was a zindiq, a non-Muslim, an enemy to Islam. He said, you know, I have spread thousands of false hadiths in the Muslims, in which uharrimu fiha al-halal wa uhallilu fiha al-haram. I have made halal into haram and haram into halal. He said that. before he died. Many, like 1100 years ago. People have tried. Remember, Muslims, you know, we have people who are enemies to Islam. It's not a new thing. It's always happened from the time of Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Try to distort the teachings of Islam. How do we know this particular hadith is correct or this is incorrect or this hadith is not really a hadith? For that, you might say this person spread thousands of hadiths, but at the same time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala utilized the people of this ummah. That they gave every ounce of their life. It's unique. Honestly, I can't even justify talking about this. It's difficult to understand how they preserved this hadith. How they preserved. We have a science called the science of al-asma'u wal-rijal. Or it's called al-jarhu wal-ta'deel. Before any hadith is transmitted, they look at that chain. Who is in that chain? Okay, Imam Bukhari is there. Today we have the Khatam of Sahih Bukhari. This man was a unique man. Unique man. An absolute gem of an individual. He is trying to gather hadiths. What does he do? He travels the world. Different muhadithun. He says, okay, what's the hadith you have? He relates the hadith with his chain. That I heard from my teacher, from his teacher, from his teacher, from his teacher. From the tabi'i, from the sahabi, from Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now this name, you could just make it up. I could just come and say to you, brother akhi, hadathana, I was heard by Shaykh, this bin this, give all these fancy names and make it up. Who are these names? I could just say, make names. I heard from Ibrahim bin Ibrahim, from Muhammad bin Muhammad, from Ismail bin Ismail, from Ayub, from Adam bin Adam, from Shaykh Fulan bin Fulan, that this tabi'i said, that Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu said. I could just make it up. They analyzed, scrutinized every single narrator. First of all, who is this guy that you're talking about? Your teacher. Your teacher, who was he? In the chain. What was his name? When was he born? Who were his teachers? Where did he study? How was his character like? How was his akhlaq? Did he offer his 5-time prayers? They will do research, minute details. Books have been written. You've got hundreds of books in hundreds of volumes. Any narrator you want to see, you pick up Sahih al-Bukhari, you find a narrator, reporter of hadith, you want to know his life story, biography, account, it's all in these books like Siyar A'lam al-Nubala, Taqreeb al-Tahdhib, Tahdhib al-Tahdhib, all these books, every detail, minute detail, they'll even tell you that they used to wear leather socks or not. Would he do masah on his leather socks or not? How would he pray salah? How would he smile? How would he talk? What would he eat? Would he eat fish or would he eat? Was he a vegetarian? Was he abil laham? Someone who doesn't eat laham. Every minute detail. You know, there was one great imam who was in this field of scrutinizing, Yahya bin Ma'in. He writes in one of his books, he says that we used to go and investigate. We used to go. When we find a hadith that there's this person in the chain, what's his name? Such and such, son of such and such. Where does he live? Kufa. Okay, let's go Kufa. We used to go spend a week in Kufa. He might be alive, he might have passed away. If he's passed away, we go to different masjids, different localities, this community. We ask the old lady, we ask his neighbor, we ask the shopkeeper, did he buy potatoes from here? Okay, was he truthful in his buying of the grocery? Did he give his debt on time? Did he take some money? Does he owe you any money? How is his character? How is his mu'amalat, his character? His monetary dealings? All absolute investigation of his akhlaq, of his character, of his mannerism, his ilm, his amal, his salah, his taqwa. Until we are not sure, we will not accept the hadith. Yahya bin Ma'in said, when we used to go and investigate in different villages and cities, people would ask us and say to us, why are you asking so much about this person? Is it so that you have received a proposal for your daughter from him? People used to think that we are asking about someone because they've received a proposal for their daughter. We will do all investigation until we give our daughter in marriage to some places. What we'll do? We'll investigate. Let's check everything. This was a matter of deen, much more important than that. And they did not differentiate between father and son and relative and nobody. Ali ibn al-Madini, he's a great muhaddith. Somebody asked him, oh Ali ibn al-Madini, your father is in one chain of hadith, he's related. Is he authentic or not? He said, sal anni ghayra. Please, brother, ask someone else. He said, no, I want to ask you, oh Imam Ali ibn al-Madini, tell me about your father. And he didn't say, my father, mera admi hai, my, you know, it's like, no. ولو على أنفسكم أو الوالدين أو الأقربين. Be just, even if it's against your own selves, your own family. He said, إِنَّ هَذَا دِينَ هَذَا دِينَ إِنَّهُ لَدَعِيفٌ. This is a matter of deen. My father, he's da'if, he's weak in hadith. Don't take hadith from him. Imam Abu Dawood, somebody asked him about his son. He said, if you want to know the truth, my son is not reliable in taking hadith from. They did not care, this is deen. And they spent, this is hundreds of years. Ali ibn al-Madini, Yahya bin Ma'in, Yahya bin Sa'id al-Qattan, these great, great, Imam al-Dhahabi, Ibn Ajar, these great imams, they spent their lives in preserving hadith by checking, scrutinizing, analyzing. To the point that, you know, there's a German non-Muslim orientalist lived in the 60s or 70s, I can't remember, Dr. Springer, I think his name is. He writes in one of his works, he says that Muslims have such a unique science that no community, no religion, no faith, no organization, no community, no one in the history of this world has been able to bring such a kind of, you know, science. And nobody until the time comes to an end, until the end of the world, will be able to bring such a science, which is the science of al-asma'u wa-rijal, preserving the biographies of the reporters of hadith. To the point, he's saying this, I'm still quoting that non-Muslim Dr. Springer, German doctor orientalist who writes on Islam. He says that to the point that today we have 500,000 people's biographies preserved in the libraries. And he says, carrying on, still quoting, he says that it is one of the wonders of the world. We think only Niagara Falls is the wonder, or the pyramids, seven wonders. This is one of the wonders of the world, that Muslims have been able to bring a science in which they check every narrator. This is the meaning. Inna nahnu nazzalna dhikra wa inna lahu lahafidhun. When we understand this, we have revealed the Quran to you. And the meaning of the Quran, which is hadith, which is sunnah, the sunnah of Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the sunnah is preserved as well. The sunnah, and this Imam al-Bukhari also had, and I'm just going to, just 2 minutes on this, and then I just need to say the last part. I'm going to, inshallah, I don't want to take too much time, but this great Imam was also one of the great people who put his piece of the effort, his part, his effort as well in preserving. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created him. It seems that Allah created him to preserve hadith, preserve sunnah. He had an amazing, amazing memory. He was born in 194 Hijri, Imam Abu Abdullah. You know his full name? His name is Imam Abu Abdullah. That's his kunya. Try to keep kunya, it's a sunnah. Abu al-Qasim sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was Abu al-Qasim. Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, that's kunya, Abu Bakr. His name was Abu Bakr. His name was Abdullah ibn Quhafa. Umar ibn al-Khattab, Umar was his name. What was his kunya? Abu Asim, Abu Hafs. Sorry, I could call you Abu Hafs. And Ula, Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu. Try to give your children, and remember, Abu doesn't mean like you have to have a son. It's good sometimes that you have a son and you call them, you know, Abu, your son's name. Like Aisha radiallahu anha was called Ummu Abdullah. She had no children. But sometimes anything, someone's handsome, you say Abu Jamil. It's a sunnah of the Sahaba, sunnah. We should bring this, revive this sunnah. My kunya is Abu Abdullah. I have a son called Abdullah. So, but you should have this kunya. It's good. Give it to our children when they grow up. Have a kunya. It's never too late. It's a sunnah of Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Sahaba. Imam al-Bukhari, he was Abu Abdullah. His name was Muhammad. His kunya was Abu Abdullah. His name was Muhammad. Muhammad bin Ismail al-Bukhari. Radiallahu anhu, may Allah be pleased with him. One of the great imams of this ummah, born in 194 Hijri. Now, Allah created him. We should read his biography. I mean, if you read his biography, he had a supernatural memory. Supernatural memory. He himself says, "Ulhimtu hifdh al-hadith." It is as though I have been inspired to preserve this hadith. I was inspired by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to preserve this hadith. At a young age, you know, in his teenage years, he knew thousands of hadiths by heart, not just the Quran. Some say at the age of 11, he, or a bit later on, he knew like 70,000 hadiths with the chain and the text, the sanad and the text by memory. Imagine, 11 years old, 70,000 hadiths. And maybe more, when he's 11, 12. Not just the Quran, we have, alhamdulillah, children memorizing the Quran. This is Imam al-Bukhari, beyond the Quran, 70,000. And actually, you know, in the olden times, the real term hafiz wasn't used for someone who memorizes the Quran. That's great, of course. But in the real term, hafiz was used for somebody who knew 100,000 hadiths by heart. That was someone who was called hafiz in the older generations. But like everything's gone down, you know, all the terms, like the term mufti, which gets used very easily on people like me. So, this was Imam al-Bukhari, rahimahullah ta'ala wa radiya anhu. He, at the age of 16, he made Hajj, and I don't want to start mentioning his biography, but I'm just trying to give a small synopsis of how he played his role in preserving hadith. He traveled to places like, you know, after Hajj, when he was 16, he went to Sham, he went to Misr, Egypt, Misr, but I'll use the Arabic tense, because Sham in that time was not just Syria, but it was all those areas, Iraq and those places. He went to Kufa, Baghdad, Basra. He took hadith from 1,080 different muhadithun. 1,080 different muhadithun. At the age of 18, he wrote his first book, Qadaya al-Sahaba wa Tabi'een. Then he wrote another book. He wrote a few other books. And as I said, 70,000. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inspired him to write this great book. This great book that we're going to complete today. What's this book? What's this book? What are we going to complete today, inshallah, today? Somebody, loudly? Sahih al-Bukhari. Okay, yeah. Bukhari is his name. He was from Bukhara. Do you know where Bukhara is? Not Alu Bukhara. But do you know where Bukhara is? Bukhara is in Uzbekistan. Travel. You know, all the six authors, Imam Bukhari, Muslim, Abu Dawud, Tirmidhi, Nasa'i, Ibn Majah, none of them are Arabs. All non-Arabs. Imam al-Bukhari is from current-day Uzbekistan. Till today, it's called Bukhara. Go on your Google Maps, put Bukhara, you'll see a map how to get to Bukhara. Bukhara's there, Samarkand is there. It's in Uzbekistan right now. I have friends from there who actually I talk to quite regularly from Uzbekistan. But there are people, you know, there's Muslims there. He was from Bukhara in Uzbekistan. The name of his book is, this is a short, we say Sahih, but there's actually a full name. Do you know what the full name of his book is? The full name of this book is Al-Jami'u al-Musnadu al-Sahihu al-Mukhtasar min Umuri Rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wa sunanihi wa ayyamihi. That's the name of the book. Al-Jami'u al-Musnadu al-Sahihu al-Mukhtasar min Umuri Rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wa sunanihi wa ayyamihi. Why such a big name? Why something not small? Because each word gives a connotation. I don't have the time, but why is it called Al-Jami'? Why is it Al-Sahih? No time. I'll just tell you why it's called Al-Mukhtasar, because that might be important. It's called Mukhtasar because Imam Al-Bukhari is telling us that, brothers and sisters, O Muslims, this is a small Mukhtasar. Everybody, lots of people who speak Urdu know what Mukhtasar means. Mukhtasar means short. This is a short collection of Sahih Hadith. That doesn't mean, brother Akhi, give me Dalil from Bukhari, that's it, and nowhere else. Imam Bukhari himself is saying, Al-Jami'u al-Musnadu al-Sahihu al-Mukhtasar. Short collection from 600 or 700,000. If I'll tell you, he actually says, خَرَّجْتُهُ مِنْ نَحْوَ 600,000. From 600,000 hadiths. He had 600,000. From there he chose how many hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari? Approximately 7,250. How many? 7,250. He selected 7,250 from about 600,000 that he already had Sahih hadith, and he just put. Because if you put all 600,000, we'll be having Abu Bakr Trust Darul Ulum for 80 years. Because every year you're reading like 100 Sahih al-Bukhari going on, how can you complete? He just took a collection and put it, which is important. Now some people make this mistake, brother, if it's Akhi, Hayakallah Akhi, give me Dalil, what's your Dalil? Brother, Akhi, I want Bukhari, that's it. But there's a hadith in Musannaf of Ibn Abi Shayba, or Imam al-Daraqutni, or Al-Bayhaqi, or it's in Kitab al-Athar of Imam Abu Hanifa, or it's there. No, brother, Akhi, I want Bukhari. It just doesn't make sense. He himself is saying that this is a short version. So what made him do this, and I will just mention this, that it took him, how many did I say? 7,250 approximately hadiths. It took him 16 years to compile. How many years? 16 years. All throughout 16 years, he kept a fast every single day. He fasted every single day, whether it's long summer fasts or short ones. There's no shortcuts here. Some people think long, 9 o'clock iftar, so they follow Makkah time sometimes, some people. I don't know where that's come from. He used to fast, and I will just mention this, that he actually put in so much effort in scrutinizing, analyzing, before including any hadith in his book. He would investigate, research. Sometimes he would travel. Like I said, there's one hadith. Okay, can I put this hadith in Sahih al-Bukhari in my book? I have to go Kufa. 3 weeks journey of Kufa. Investigating, narrate, you know, checking this narrator, that reporter, checking everything. Has he heard from him? Maybe it takes him 6 months to do research before including one hadith in his book. That's why it takes 16 years. You might say, why does it take 16 years? He spent his day and night, and he was very popular. He went to one muhaddith. Someone said he's got a hadith which is very unique. Go to him, take that hadith, hear it from him, and put it in your book. He traveled to another city. I can't remember where, another city, Kufa, Basra, or somewhere. When he went to that muhaddith was outside. You know, he had his animal, horse or donkey, one of the animals, and he was calling the animal, and he was saying, come here, come here, come here, like making noise. Come, come, you know, just pretending that he's got some grass or what do you call it? Hay, or to, you know, for the animal. He said, come here. And he didn't have anything, he was just trying to get the animal. Imam Bukhari looked at him and said, have you got the hay in your hands? This is, he's made a 2 week journey to just go to take hadith from. He said, no, I'm just, that animal doesn't come to me. He said, how can I take a hadith? Amman yakdhibu ala al-baha'im, the one who lies to animals, how can I take hadith from him? Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, see you later. He didn't take a hadith from him. This is how particular he was. This is how particular he was. He was meticulous. He would go to the depth, every possible means that he had of investigating. He investigated. Until he didn't get to the depth, he did not include a hadith in his book. And had very strict conditions. And that's why he did all of that. And then I just want to end with this. Finally, what he did was, subhanallah, he asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He did, this is why, you know, a lot of people make a mistake. We have two types of people in this world, like in Muslims. Ifrat, tafrit. Some people, some of us, we only rely on asbab. We have a job interview, we want work, we want employment, we want any worldly. We take all the worldly means. As for asking Allah, dua, istikhara, we don't even think about that. It's all just taking worldly means as well. Other people, they just rely on istikhara and dreams. Everything, I do istikhara. That's it. I've asked Allah. What about the means? Islam says take a balance. Tie the camel, tie the knot, tie the camel, then rely on Allah. We have been, you know, with istikhara, this is a side issue. People ask about istikhara. Istikhara, many people have misunderstood what istikhara is. Istikhara is asking Allah for khair. You know what istikhara means? It's not just for marriage, by the way, yeah? Istikhara is for everything. Istikhara is for anything. Some pious people used to do istikhara every day of their life. They wake up in the morning after Ishraq, they do istikhara. Why? Oh Allah, I'm asking you today, inshallah, I'm going for my job, I'm going out of the house, etc., etc. I ask you, place barakah in my day, in my work, in my job, in my driving, in my journey. If anything goes wrong, then protect me from it, and then go. They don't. It doesn't mean that they do istikhara and then go back to sleep and say, let me see a dream whether I should go work or not. No. Before marriage, this is what it is. Istikhara. You do all whatever's in your means, and then at the end you do istikhara. Anyway, Imam Bukhari took all the means of ensuring that the hadith is sahih. At the end, he says that مَا وَضَعْتُ فِي كِتَابِ السَّحِيحِ حَدِيثًا إِلَّا اغْتَسَلْتُ قَبْلَ ذَلِكَ وَصَلَّيْتُ رَكْعَتَيْنِ وَاسْتَخَرْتُ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى وَتَيَقَّنْتُ صِحَّتَهُ. I did not place any hadith in my book until I did not make a ghusl before every hadith. How many hadiths I told you in Sahih al-Bukhari? 7,250 approximately. There's some versions, there's numberings. That means he took 7,250 baths ghusl. Before every hadith, ghusl. I did ghusl. I offered 2 rak'ah. Before every hadith, 2 rak'ah. Nafil salah. Salatul istikhara, or haja, or shukr, or whatever, niyah. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How many rak'ahs did you offer? How many rak'ahs? 7,250? No. Rak'atayn. What is it? 14,500. And? Yeah, rak'at, yeah, 14,500 rak'at. And I made istikhara for every single hadith. Before every hadith, saying, oh Allah, I've traveled here, I've done this, I've done that, I've done every tahqiq research, I've put all the effort in for you. Now finally I ask you, Allah, that, you know, place barakah and blessings, and if this hadith is not supposed to be here, stop me from putting it in this book of mine. And I made sure that it was sahih. This is Imam al-Bukhari, just an example. So I'm just going to conclude. This was just a small synopsis, what he did. So this was the second part. Quickly, first part, Allah said, we have revealed the Quran to you. We shall protect the Quran, the words of the Quran. Number two, preservation is guaranteed for the hadith. Yeah? Do you remember what I was saying in the beginning? We have revealed the dhikr to you. Allah has promised us He will preserve the Quran. I told you about the Bible, etc. The Quran word is revealed, preserved. And the sunnah, hadith is also preserved. Number three, and I will end with this, and very shortly, briefly on this. Not just the Quran text is preserved, not just the hadith text is preserved, just 5 minutes on this. Even the understanding of the Quran and hadith is preserved. What does that mean, even the understanding? Even the understanding of the Quran and Sunnah is preserved. The interpretation of the Quran and Sunnah. Look, brothers, if you listen to this carefully, it's very important. Who heard the Quran and who heard the hadith directly from the mouth of Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Who heard? The Sahaba. Now, someone who's hearing directly, would that person understand? Like, if I speak to you directly right now, like you are listening to me right now, you go back home and tell your friend what I said. Do you understand better? Will you be understanding better, or he will be understanding better? You will be. You're looking at me, you're looking at my actions, I'm doing this and I'm doing that, and I'm tone. Sometimes you say someone, go. There's actually 18 meanings of the Amr. You tell someone, you know, a student comes to you, you're a teacher. He's been skiving every day. I want to go home, I've got a headache. No, no, no. Go back to class. He comes back after 10 minutes. I've got a headache, you know. No, go back to class. He came 10 times. You got a headache because he keeps it. Okay, go. Is that okay, go? Different to you got a very good student who never misses class and he says, Ustad, Sheikh, today I've got a bit of headache. I want to go home. Okay, take, go. One is okay, go. Okay, go. Both. One is yes, one is no. Who understands that? In the hadith book, it won't be one written in red ink and one in green ink. They're both in the black ink. It's exactly written the same way. Amr. This is just one example. This is a topic on its own. The Sahaba who heard the voice, who heard the tone, who understood how it was said, what action Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam made. They took that understanding of the Quran, that understanding of the Sunnah, they passed and transmitted that understanding to who? Their students, and then their students, and their students, and then their students, till today. And today we have our teachers, mashayikh, ulama. That's why, look, in Islam, we don't have scholars creating a monopoly. We don't own. This is not Christianity. In Christianity, what the Pope says becomes religion. This is not Christianity. In Christianity, even in Shiaism, what happens is what the Grand Ayatollah says, they are considered to be infallible. What they say, they're like Anbiya, infallible according to them. What they say becomes deen. According to us, no. The greatest alim sheikh can make a mistake and everyone can disagree. But the understanding, the real understanding of what Quran means, what's the real explanation of this hadith, it is only valid when it's come through generation from generation from generation. This understanding has been coming through. Today we find people making all sorts of statements. I heard recently somebody was saying that, where is it in the Quran? Hijab is not fard. Hijab is not fard in the Quran. There are verses because they're ambiguous. Hijab is not fard. Where does it say in the Quran that women have to wear hijab? This verse. But this verse could mean this as well. Yeah, it's true, it could mean that maybe 2%. This verse, No, but this is also, you know, in the Quran, Allah says, wadrib, anyway, I don't give that example, but there's different, you can just literally, you know, wadribuhunna, they said, travel with them. Safiruhunna. This is what they did. Any explanation you can give. Because Arabic language, you can just completely change everything. Therefore, only that explanation of the Quran and Sunnah will be valid, will be acceptable, will be correct, which has come from generation, from our shuyukh, from their teachers, the fuqaha, all the way going to the sahaba. So this is the third part of the preservation of deen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took it upon himself to preserve this deen. This includes three parts. Preserve the text of the Quran. Number two, preserve the sunnah. And number three, the meaning and understanding of the Quran and sunnah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us tawfiq, inshallah. Today, I would just like, if I can ask Mawlana Luqman, just 1 minute on Mufitaq Usmani. I've already said it. We are very honored and privileged today. You see his name here, Shaykh al-Islam, Shaykh al-Hadith, Mufti Muhammad Taqi Uthmani, Hafidhahullah. Seriously, people ask sometimes me and others about him, or ask, you know, and normally, the only thing I can say, that this individual is such that we are fortunate. Seriously, you will not understand. I don't understand him myself. They say, إِنَّمَا يَعْرِفُ الْفَضْلَ لِأَهْلِ الْفَضْلِ ذَوُ الْفَضْلِ. The true virtue of the people of virtue is only understood by those of virtue. That's why, you know, in the morning we had an ulama program here. There were more scholars sitting by him than there's people here. Because scholars understand him more. They realize his maqam and his position. This is a unique man. I normally say that we are privileged and fortunate just to be living in the same time in this world that he's living. That's honestly. Today we're going to see him, inshallah. But we are fortunate just to be living. Like one of the sheikhs said that, you know, it seems as though there was a train traveling, and in there was Mawlana Shabri Tanwi rahimahullah, Rashid Ahmed Gangohi, and Mawlana Ilyas rahimahullah, and, you know, Khalil Ahmed Saharanpuri rahimahullah, and Mawlana Hussein Ahmed Madani and Qasim Nanoti. All of them were there, and they were traveling in a train, and the train left, and one guy got left behind, which was Mufti Taqi Usmani. And this, I heard this from a great person. He is of that caliber. Seriously, you look at him, I mean, it's difficult to understand unless you sort of realize and read his works. Mawlana Luqman, mashallah, may Allah preserve and protect him. He's invited him, not just this year, but last year and a few years, 5-6 years. And mashallah, Mufti Taqi Usmani has a lot of love for him. And the institute, he comes here, he's been coming for the past few years. Take, you know, this opportunity to benefit from him. And you know, you try to spread, you know, tell people, others to come. Someone like him, when he went to India in 2011, there was 80,000 people who came to listen to his talks in Deoband. In Deoband, people were climbing on lampposts, on trees, in Deoband. There was national holiday in Darul Uloom, Deoband. The whole madrasa, from the Sheikh al-Hadith to the last man, they all were given holiday. And everyone, like, from the greatest Sheikh al-Hadith would come to, sat as a student in front of him. This is a type of caliber. He's the author of numerous books in English, Urdu, Arabic. He wrote a book which took him good many 18 years, which is a Sharah, you know, of Sahih Muslim in Arabic, six, seven volumes, commentary. People think, oh, Mufti Taqi Usmani, Islamic banking. No, brother. That's just like 10% of his work. You know, it's not just that's what he does. Many, many things. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the benefit to listen to him and all the rest of our great mashayikh, Mawlana Fazlur Rahim, Sheikh Saeed Ahmed Inayatullah, as well as others. May Allah grant us tawfiq. And I'm sorry if I've gone above time.